Okay, good afternoon, all of you. Any questions from last class? So let me start presenting. So hope you are seeing this one. So last class we looked at how to solve these kind of problems, or we went through the procedure. What is the how to calculate equivalent load when these beam-like structural members are subjected to differential temperature on either side of the, or either surfaces, top and bottom surfaces. And we have noted yesterday, when there is this kind of temperature difference, with the temperature on the top surface being higher than bottom surface, if beam is free, it's going to achieve some curvature. It's going to attain some curvature, which can be calculated using this relation, which is nothing but coefficient of thermal expansion times gradient of the temperature. This coefficient of thermal expansion multiplied by this is a difference in temperature between top and bottom surfaces, divided by the depth of the beam. Okay, so once you get the curvature, you can relate to bending moment, and then if the ends are restrained, so that is going to be the reaction that is going to be developed at the ends. So the equivalent force vector can be obtained using this. So if ends are fixed, using the sign convention for applied forces and moments, we can put this whatever moments that are shown here in a vector as per the sign convention that we are adopting. Applied moments are going to be positive if they are acting in the counterclockwise direction. So the load vector is going to be 0 minus mft 0 plus mft, and that is going to be the load vector coming from the fixed end moments. We need to reverse it, and then that is going to be the load that we are going to apply. That is going to be the resultant equivalent load, okay, or equivalent load that we need to apply. And using this, you need to solve the problem and apply fixed end correction. This all we discussed in yesterday's class, okay. And for this kind of problem, because of this differential temperature, only the moments are going to be developed, no shear force is going to be developed. Okay? The moment is going to be uniform moment. What is shear force? Shear force is derivative of bending moment. So if a moment is uniform, it's constant, shear force is going to be zero. Anyway, I also suggested you to go through all this before you come for today's class. So now let's go and look at this problem. Please take a note of this problem. Here you have a cantilever beam. Let's read the problem statement. Determine the bending moment and shear forces. It's not continuous beam. You can say it's a cantilever beam or propped cantilever, or you can just strike out this one. determine bending moment and shear forces in beam shown in figure here. The beam is subjected to linear temperature change of 50 Fahrenheit through the depth. So the differential temperature is 50 Fahrenheit, and other things are all given in FPS units. I told you, you just use consistent units and solve it. It should not be a problem. Okay. So because of this temperature difference between top and bottom surfaces, the beam is going to bend. Our beam is going to have some curvature. Okay, and it's going to bend down. And when it tries to bend down, it is going to compress the spring. So the force that is going to be developed in the spring is going to be compressive force. So please take a note of this problem. And you see how the nodes are numbered. This is numbered as 1, this node is numbered as 2, this node is numbered as 3. Okay, that numbering is arbitrary. You can adopt different numbering. Okay. And beam element is shown separately. What are the degrees of freedom for the beam element? What are the degrees of freedom for the spring element? They are shown here. Okay, so please take a note of this figure. Have a class. What you want? Yes. Anyways, can you send the email? Yeah. Thank you. Hopefully you have taken note of this problem, okay? So now, please note that there is no external force that is applied, external moment or external loads that are applied on the beam. Beam is subjected to differential temperature, that's it, okay? So because of that, what are going to be the forces and stresses that are going to be developed in this these two structural members, we need to estimate. So before that, please note that this is a beam element. This is a beam. And forget about the boundary condition for a while here. It is fixed here and it is free here, and at the free end the spring is attached. Okay? For a while, forget about the boundary conditions for this beam element. With whatever we learned in yesterday's class, if suppose this beam element is fixed, both ends are fixed, what is going to be the moment that is going to be developed? Fixed end moment. That is given by this one. Please take a note of this. Why we are noting down this one? Because we want to when we want to solve this problem, we have an equation system for beam, we have an equation system for bar element. We have equation system for beam element, we have equation system for bar element. And that equation system, you have stiffness matrix multiplied by nodal degrees of freedom. On the right hand side, you have the force vector. So we need to apply equivalent load corresponding to this temperature difference. How do we get equivalent load for beam element? First of all, equivalent load vector consists of force at node 1, moment at node 1, force at node 2, moment at node 2. And now we need to find what are the equivalent values, because equivalent values of those forces and moments because of this temperature difference. For that, we are noting down this fixed end moment. And we know that whatever discussions we had, and I repeatedly told you that load vector can also be obtained by putting the fixed end solution, fixed end forces and moments in a vector form for that particular beam element subjected to same loads and reversing the sign. So that is going to be equivalent load vector. That is how you are going to get equivalent load vector for this beam. And what about the spring? Here there is no equivalent load. There is no additional load applied on this spring. And you know the equation system for a bar element. For a bar element, the equation system is going to be, what is going to be the equation system for a bar element? AE over L. Please make a note, AE over L, that is axial rigidity or axial stiffness, AE over L. And in you have 2x2 stiffness matrix. The components are going to be 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. And what about the load vector for this particular case? Load vector is going to be 0. And please note that you should be careful which node for this spring element, which node you are calling it as local node 1, which node you are calling as local node 2. That you need to be careful. So please take a note of this. Please take a note of this problem. So now we need to get the equation system, global equation system for this structural system that is shown here, which comprises of beam and a spring. You need to know what is the equation, element equation system for a beam element, as well as element equation system for a bar element. So now let's write element this. The nodes are numbered like this, 1, 2, 3. So first, the structural member that is connecting nodes 1 and 2 is beam element. So we need to write for nodes, for this member, we need to make use of element equations for beam. And the structural element that is connecting nodes 2 and 3 is a spring element. Okay. So bar element. So let's see equation system for, first let's see equation system for this beam element. E value is given, I value is given, length is given. So you can easily find what is the EI, what is this quantity EI divided by L. So then go to the element equations for beam element. Element equations for beam element. Just one second. Yeah, this is the element equation for this beam element. So EI is given, L is given. So you can easily find this coefficient and all the components in the stiffness matrix. You can easily find because length of the beam element is known. And what are going to be the degrees of freedom? V1 theta 1, V2 theta 2. And here load vector. This is what I was explaining. So now we don't have distributed load. We have these equivalent point loads to, because of this temperature difference. How do you get the equivalent load vector? You write the fixed end moment, fixed end forces and moments, and reverse this sign. You are going to get this. There is no force, zero, and M1. If you follow the sign convention, it is minus MFT, 0 plus MFT, and reverse the sign of that vector. So the equivalent load vector is going to be 0 MFT, 0 minus MFT. So that is what is going to be your load vector for this beam element here. Just one second, let me, because that's why I'm saying you need to make a note of it so that. So this is the equation system for beam element. What is this? 125 is nothing but MFT. 125 is nothing but MFT. What did I say? 0 MFT, 0 minus MFT. So this is going to be the equation system for beam element. And please note that, you need to be very careful which of the nodes you are calling as local node 1, which of the node is you are calling as local node too. Okay, that you need to be very, very careful. So please take a note of it. So whatever I explained to you, equivalent load vector can be obtained by fixed end moments with sign like, you know, you use the sign convention and then put it in a vector, reverse the sign, then you are going to get this vector. So please take a note of this equation system. And once you are comfortable with solving this kind of thing, or once you understand this kind of problem, it has a lot of application, okay? Because please note that in a problem, we may not have beam element alone. We may not have truss element or a bar element alone. So we may have combination of all these kind of elements. Then in that case, the degrees of freedom for beam elements are different from degrees of freedom for bar elements. So how do I couple them? Which degree of freedom I need to couple? That kind of thing, understanding you will get once you solve this problem. So this is the equation system for beam element. What about equation system for bar element or the spring element? What are the degrees of freedom for spring element? Node 2 and node 3, and degrees of freedom are going to be the axial displacement at node 2, axial displacement at node 3. Axial displacement at node 2, axial displacement at node 3. And you know, spring constant is directly given, K value is directly given. Spring constant is nothing but in your bar element, AE divided by L, that is nothing but stiffness. It's nothing but spring constant. Okay? So the equation system for the spring is going to be like this. Equation system for spring is going to be like this. This is nothing but spring stiffness K, which is nothing but if you want to find equivalent bar element, then that bar cross A area of cross section times Young's modulus of the bar divided by L should be equal to 5. Okay, and I want you to pay attention to this here. Please note that V3 and V2 are written here. V3 and V2 are written. That means node 3 is considered as first node for bar element. Node 2 is considered as second node for bar element. Okay? So please take a note of it. And there is no load vector on this spring element. So load vector is 0. So now you got equation system for beam element, equation system for spring element. Now you need to put all these two equations together and get the global equation system. How do I get global equation system? First, I need to write the degrees of freedom vector. What are the degrees of freedom? V1, theta 1, V2, theta 2. And then for the spring element, you have only V3. There is no theta 3. V3. This is going to be V3. So write V1, theta 1, V2, theta 2, V3. And once you have that, then you need to see which contribution is going to come. Here, the degrees of freedom are these first 4 degrees are freedom are V1, theta 1, V2, theta 2. So they are matching with this one. So this entire stiffness, all this 4x4 stiffness is going to go and occupy 4x4, 1 to 4 rows and 1 to 4 columns locations. 1 to 4 rows, 1 to 4 column locations it's going to occupy. It's a straightforward beam. Okay. And now where the contribution from a spring element is going to go? What is this location? What is this location? This location 5 corresponds to v3 and v2. Okay, or let's number this vector as 1. This, let's say this is 1 2 3 4 5. So let's number this as 1, this component as 1. V1 is numbered as 1, theta 1 is numbered as 2, V2 is numbered as 3, theta V2 is numbered as 3, theta 2 is numbered as 4, V3 is numbered as 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So beam element stiffness contribution directly goes into 1 to 4 rows and columns. What about the contribution from this?
Hello. Sir, you are not audible. There was some power problem here. Okay, I hope all of you are still there.
Yes, sir.
So there is some power problem, and now I connected through my mobile. I hope you are seeing this. So you are able to see this one slide?
Yes, sir.
So now the thing is, you need to pay attention to this spring, how you numbered. So what I'm saying is, this V1 is, let's say this location is 1 2 3 4. So 1 to 4 rows and columns directly this beam element stiffness contribution goes in. And what about the rest? Where the rest
where this spring element contribution is going to go. That how do I get it? So I numbered this as 4 and 5. So what is the location corresponding to, what is the number of location corresponding to V2? It is 3. And what is the number of location corresponding to V3? It is 5. So this location is 3. This location is 5. This location is 3. This location is 5. So here also you need to adopt same numbering. So call this as 3 and 5. So this is going to be 3-3 location. This is going to go to 3-5 location. This is going to go to 5-3 location. This is going to go to 5-5 location. Please take a note of it. Sorry, here this is 5 and this is 3. So this is 5. V3 is 5 and this is 3. So this contribution goes into 5-5 location, 5-3, 3-5, 3-3. Please take a minute and see if there is any confusion here. Because the number that I gave to V3 is here, the location is 5. So this is 5 and V2 is at 3, this is 3. So this one has to go into 5-5 location, this has to go into 5-3 location, 3-5 location and 3-3 location. So once you have an understanding of that, you just plug in the values here, that is what is shown. This goes into where? This goes into 5-5 location. This goes into 5-3 location. Sorry, this is, 5th row, 5-3 location, and this goes into 3-5 location, 3rd row, 5th column, and this is going to go to 3-3 location. Is it clear how the contribution from spring? So you need to be very careful which one you are calling as node 3, which one you are calling as node 2. Sorry, which one you are calling as node 1, which one you are calling as node 1 and node 2 locally for an element. So once you have this global equation system, by appropriately putting the contribution of different types of elements, please note that here, so far we studied only one-dimensional problems, beam elements and bar elements is what you have studied. And that too, you have studied only 2-node beam element, 2-node bar element. So if I want to combine both of these, how do I do it? This problem is illustrating that one. Once you get global equation system, now you apply the boundary conditions. What are the boundary conditions for this problem? This is fixed. That means transverse displacement as well as rotations are zero here. Transverse displacement rotations are 0. V1, theta 1 is 0. And this is free. And whereas this is fixed. So V3 is 0. So V1, theta 1 and V3 are 0. Wherever, whichever degrees of freedom are 0, corresponding locations, reaction is going to be there. If it is a displacement, corresponding force is going to be developed. If it is rotation, corresponding moment is going to be developed. So applying the boundary conditions, V1 is equated to 0, theta 1 is equated to 0, V3 is equated to 0, corresponding location reaction is going to be developed. Already at this location, 125 is there. In addition to that, some unknown moment is going to be developed. So this entire quantity is unknown. So this is 0, this is 0, this is 0. So location 1 is 0, 2 is 0, 5 is 0. So eliminating rows and columns corresponding to 1, 2, 5, you get the reduced equation system. You solve the reduced equation system for V2 and theta 2. So please take a note of this quickly. Please take a note of this quickly. So now, once we get V2 and theta 2, once we get V2 and theta 2, we need to go back to each of the element and determine what are the forces. Forces in the sense, for a beam element, if you are interested in finding displacement along the length of the beam, rotation along the length of the beam, bending moment, shear force along the length of the beam, you can do all that. Once we need the, once we know the nodal degrees of freedom, V1 theta 1, V2 theta 2. So now let's go to beam element. And bending moment can be obtained. Here, here bending moment is alone shown. Bending moment is obtained by EI times second derivative of V with respect to X, or second derivatives of shape function multiplied by the second derivative of shape functions to get the second derivative of displacement. We need to have second derivative of shape functions multiplied by the nodal values multiplied by EI divided by L square. So this is going to give you the interpolation for bending moment. And please note that this is in this problem, the moment is going to be uniform along the length of the beam. So you need to apply fixed end correction. That fixed end correction is there here. If you don't apply this fixed end correction, this bending moment is not going to be correct. Because when you have temperature, thermal stresses, the additional thermal, additional loading due to thermal related effects, then moment is going to be uniform. So it's going to be similar to uniformly distributed load problem. So you need to apply fixed end correction. And what about shear? Shear, you need to take third derivative of shape functions. Third derivative of shape function multiplied with the nodal values multiplied with this EI over L cube. And what about the correction here? Is it required? Please note that because of this thermal loading, only uniform bending moment is going to be developed. There is no shear force. So shear force correction is zero. Shear force correction is not required. So please take a note of this. So this, if you sweep this expression or this, using this relation, if you sweep from 0 to 1, you will get the entire bending moment variation. Sweeping from S is equal to 0 to S is equal to 1, you get the entire bending moment variation. Similarly, shear force is going to be constant. Shear force is going to be constant everywhere, so it's going to be same everywhere. So these are the stress resultants that are going to be developed in the beam element. What about the force in the spring element? Force in the spring element is obtained by spring stiffness multiplied by the difference in the displacement between node 1 and node 2 locally for this spring. For this spring, what are the degrees of freedom in this particular problem? V2 and V3 are the degrees of freedom corresponding to this spring. So if you want to find the spring force, it's going to be stiffness coefficient multiplied by the difference between V2 and V3. Difference between V2 and V3. Because V3 is considered as node 1. V2 is considered as node 2. In this particular case, V3 is considered as, or this degree of freedom corresponding to
node 1 locally for the spring element. This corresponds to the degree of freedom for second node locally. So it's going to be V2 second node displacement minus first node displacement. V2 minus V3 multiplied by the stiffness, spring stiffness. V3 is 0 and V2 just now we found. So this is what you get. And V2 is minus some quantity multiplied by the spring stiffness. And it turns out that this force is negative. Negative means it's compressive force. Spring, the force in the spring is going to be compressive force. Is correct or not? You draw the free body diagram, and then similar to what I explained to you for self-checking of the solution that you get for a beam. Self-checking of solution that you get for a beam. Same thing you need to do here. Okay? You please go through this procedure, and if you have any doubt, we will discuss further. This is only for the sake of self-checking whether the solution that you got some values. How do you know that is correct or not? You draw the free body diagram for each of this. You draw the free body diagram for each of these elements, whether it is beam element or a spring element. Follow the sign conventions. Draw the free body diagram and check whether each of these element independently is in equilibrium or not, and together they are in equilibrium or not. Okay, so go through this example, which is very, very, like, you know, it gives a lot of information, and the experience that you gain by solving this kind of problem helps you to combine different elements that you learn as a part of this course. Okay, so that completes beam element, and I'm going to give you introduction to frame element. Frame is nothing but a combination of beam and a bar and a beam element. A combination of bar and beam element is this frame element. And here, please note that, I think just now power has come here. Please note that this, when you have this axial effects along with bending effects, that is what is frame. But as far as this course is concerned, we assume that axial effects and bending effects are independent. Okay, usually when you have axial force along with bending, okay, that axial force is going to result in additional bending, or it's going to result in additional moment. But that kind of coupling we are not going to consider, because we are learning, is this the first course, so we assume that they are uncoupled. Okay, with that introduction, let's go and read this. Members in a plane frame, again similar to plane truss space truss, you have plane frame, frame element, or frame elements in the plane of the board, and frame elements coming out of the plane of the board. So plane frames and space frames, similar to plane truss and space truss. Okay, so plane frame element. Members in plane frame are designed to resist axial and bending deformations. The two-dimensional beam element and axial deformation elements are combined together to form an element which can be used to analyze any planar framework. It is assumed that axial and bending effects are uncoupled from each other, which is a reasonable assumption within the framework of small deformation theory. Okay, so
whatever you learn, beam element equations, bar element equations, you put together. In between, we looked at this example. This example, we have two elements combined. And how this example gives you an idea how to actually, if I want to combine these two, where the contribution from each of these, how from two different types of elements, and the global stiffness, where the contribution is going to go. That kind of thing you will experience here. So similar thing you need to do here. You have equation system for a beam element. You have equation system for a bar element. You need to come up with equation system for frame element, putting these whatever contributions because of bending effects, contribution from axial effects in appropriate locations in the global equation system. So please take a note of this figure. Please take a note of this figure. This figure actually gives you nodal degrees of freedom as well as applied nodal loads. Applied loads, actually. What are the nodal degrees of freedom? Axial effects. Because of axial effect, what is the nodal degree of freedom? D1 at node 1, D4 at node 2, because of axial effects. And D2 is because of bending, transverse displacement. D3, rotation at node 1. D5 is transverse displacement at node 2. D6 is rotation at node 2. You see the sign convention. Sign convention is exactly the same as what we followed for beams. Nodal degrees of freedom and applied moments and forces are going to be positive for beam element if the moments are acting in the counterclockwise direction. So rotation should be in the counterclockwise direction for them to be positive. And transverse displacement acting in the upward direction are positive. And what about axial forces? Axial D1, when it is positive, if it is acting in the direction of positive x-axis. D1, D4 are positive if they are acting in positive direction of x-axis. Similarly, the nodal forces. Once you understood this, this is straightforward. So please take a note of this figure. So what are the nodal degrees of freedom for a frame element, plane frame element? Nodal degrees of freedom are 1, D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, D6. But you should be very clear what D1 stands for, what D2 stands for, all these things. Because without proper understanding of that, you will not know where to put the contribution from the beam action, where to put the contribution from the axial deformation action. Okay? And what about the load vector? Load vector is going to be fx1, fx1, fy1, m1, fx2, fy2, m2. That is how the load vector is going to look like. So please take a note of this figure. Once you have this figure, it's easy to write the equation system for frame element. Once you have the beam element equation system, once you have bar element equation system, it's easy to write for this frame element. And please note that whatever equations we are writing, they are under the assumption that axial and bending effects are uncoupled. That is possible only if the deformations are small. So we are focusing only on small deformation kind of situation. Okay, that means you don't have excessive rotations and other things. So with this understanding, let me show you what is the equation system for a bar element, what is the equation system for a beam element with corresponding degrees of freedom. For bar element D1, D4,
for beam element D2, D3, D5, D6. And then you write the global equation system like this. Or I cannot say global equation system. I will say this as equation, element equation for a frame element. To get element equation for a frame element, you write all the degrees of freedom corresponding to the frame D1, D2, D3, D1x or fx1, m1, fx2. Now you fill in this. This is going to be 6x6 matrix, where the contribution from this beam, this contribution, where it goes into? It goes into the location 2, 3, 4, 5. 2, 3, 4, 5 location, sorry. 2, 3, 5, and 6. So you number this as 2, this as 3, 5, 6. So this location goes into 2, 2 location, 2, 3 location, and what about this? 2, 5 location, 2, 6 location. This is going, this will go into this, this where this is going to go into, this will go into, you can see here, 3, 2 location, 3, 3 location, 3, 5, 3, 6. Where this will go? 5, 2, 5, 3, 5, 5, 5, 6. 6, 2, 6, 3, 6, 5, 6, 6. So this is where this contribution goes into the glow, frame equation. And what about this contribution, where it goes into? This is 1 and 4. So this goes into 1, 1, 1 location. This will go into 1, 4, 4, 1, 4, 4 locations. So you can see, at least that you can check, where this will go into 1, 1. That is this one. A1 is nothing but that. 1, 1 location. What did I say about this? This will go into 1, 4 location. This will go into 4, 1 location. It's symmetric, that's why it's not shown. And this will go into 4, 4 location. So this is how you get the element equation for a frame element. Once you get element equation for a frame element, please note that this frame element is like this, with its local x-axis oriented like this. Okay. And so it is written as KLDL is equal to RL. This is a local equation system for a frame element. And in a particular case, if you have this frame element oriented other than nicely, like horizontal one here, if it is oriented or inclined with respect to the global axis, global X and Y, similar to the truss element, plane truss, with respect to the global X and Y axis, is this local X, local Y, if they are oriented, what is the relation? What is the relation? Okay? So all that is given here. And what is your transformation matrix? Please note that transformation matrix, you know, transformation matrix for a this coordinate system. Okay. Anyway, I think time is running out, so let's look at this in the next class. Okay, this how to get for a frame element which is inclined with respect to the global axis. So that is what I'm trying to explain, but because of lack of time, we'll continue in tomorrow's class or next class. So at least you please try to be comfortable till this point. So frame element is a combination of beam element and a bar element. and where the contribution from beam or bending effects is going to go, and where the contribution from axial effects is going to go into the frame element equation depends on the degrees of freedom, how you number them. Okay, so at least you understand that one. We'll continue in next class. So this is going to be KL DL is equal to RL. Okay. Any questions here? Sorry, there is some power problem. Other than that, I hope everything is clear. If it is not clear, please let me know. Any questions? You need to put some additional effort, understand? As we are progressing, things are getting complicated. It's not as simple as what you learned for a bar element and a beam element. They're going to get complicated, so you need to put your effort. Okay? Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, let me stop here.